Okay, so we've done some simulation, and that's great, and it's really useful. Now it's time to try out how to do debugging on actual hardware. So in the labs for EECS 2021, you'll be debugging on boards like this, or maybe like this. Very unlikely, but you know, maybe a board like this. All of these have an actual PIC32 chip on them, and it's possible to send the program in, to modify it, and to monitor what's going on inside. So let's take a look at how to do that. So what we're going to do is look at the wiki.microchip website, and we're looking specifically at Lab 3, debugging on hardware. So at this point, it's assumed that you've done Lab 1 and Lab 2, that you have a good working installation of MPLAB X, and that you actually have purchased a copy of the hardware. So what we're going to do is get you to start up a new project and to insert code into that project. So I'm going to start up like this. I'm going to show you that I've got some code right here. And it's very similar to the code that we had before. I'm going to copy it. And I'm going to go over to MPLAB X and start a new project. So File, New Project, Microchip Embedded Standalone Project. And once again, remember that in my case, and this will be different for you, I'm using this board. So the board with the PIC32 MX250 F128B on it. And the LED that I'm going to flash is on port A. On another board, say the UC32 or the WF32, the LED might be on a different port and a different pin, and we'll have to have different instructions and different source code to make it work. So please refer to the notes in the lab for how to do that on the other boards. So in this case, we have the PIC32 250 F128B, and it has an LED attached to pin 0 of port A. So I'm going to select 32-bit PIC32s. I'm going to select the 250 F128B next. Now, instead of choosing the simulator, I am going to use the starter kit microstick debugger. It's specific to this board. It's actually the chips and circuitry that's found right here and right there. On other boards, you'll be using debuggers similar to this, the PIC-Kit 3. So for any of the boards that came from ChipKit, there's a specific debugger that you have that is similar, but not quite like this one. And you'll have to select it from the menu. In my case, I'm using the MicroStick built-in debugger. I still choose XC32. I'm going to call this Lab03. I had one before, I'm renaming it and writing over the old one. I say finish. It's not letting me do that, so we'll call it something else. Lab3 new. We'll call it new. Like that. There we go. Okay, I go over to the left-hand side. I right-click on source files. I say new. Other C main file. We're going to call this Lab3 main. I'm going to blast away the template that's right here with the code that is provided. And that code has the ever helpful xc.h header file. And very importantly, it has all of these configuration registers. And these are super important because they tell the chip, prior to the actual execution of the main loop, how to set up its internal clock in terms of timing, as well as to turn off things like a watchdog timer and to turn off the JTAG debugger. Now, on the other boards, there probably is not a JTAG attached to the chip, so you probably not have to include that. You might get a warning if you try to do so. And we'll have separate instructions on how to set this up for the WF32, the UC32, or the DP32 boards from ChipKit. Other changes is that we've added another global variable called global delay val, and this is similar to the global variable called delay val in the lab 3 on wikidot. I've added the word global in front because I think it's important that we have all global variables named in a very obvious way. From there, the latch A and tri-state A values are set. The delay and latch assignments are the same as before. The only big difference is that rather than have a hard-coded value for the delay parameter, I've changed it to an actual variable because we'll change that inside of the debugging of the hardware. From there, everything else is effectively the same. All right. Now, at this point, what we're going to do is show you that nothing is going on this particular board. The LED is not flashing. And I'm going to go up to the top here and click on Debug Main Project. So I click on that. And at the bottom, we'll see that we're launching and we're programming and firmware is being checked and it's ensuring that we've got a particular type of device and then it programs and all of these things are happening. And we'll see eventually that the system will be programmed. A warning or status message will show up. And what we're hearing here, or seeing here, I'm sorry, is that the target was running and now it's halted. So it was running, it's now halted, and that's because I'd set it up to break at main. All right, so there's the board. The board is not flashing the LEDs. And if we go into preferences, that's right, go into preferences, you'll see that under embedded, let's not reset, but debug startup has been set to halt at main. And that's effectively what's just happened. The green arrow right here shows us that we've halted at main. So I am going to step into the main function. And you'll notice that this is very, very similar to what was going on in simulation. I've now got the possibility of actually reading the actual value of the latch A inside of this chip. It's no longer a computer simulation. And if I step through, let's do this. Step, step, step. Actually, let's see. We will put the cursor there. And we're going to say run to cursor. And would you look at that? The LED has turned on. And the reason the LED has turned on is because the latch assignment here has executed. If I continue and put the cursor there and say run to cursor, watch that red LED. You'll see it turn off. See, it turned off. If I then press continue like this, watch what happens. The code on the code that we have written is now executing on the chip. We can see at the bottom of the MPLAB X IDE that it says lab 3 is effectively running. That's why the candy bar status meter is running like that. At the same time, we can see that in the real world, not in simulation, but in the real world, the board is also running. We can pause execution of the code like this. You'll notice that the LED is no longer flashing. And in the code itself, in the C code, we'll see that the program counter arrow is pointing at this while loop right here inside of delay. OK. Okay, so what can we do here? Well, at this point, I can show you how we can monitor different variables inside of the code. So we go to Window, Debugging, Watches. Here's the tab that opens up. I right-click on it. I say New Watch. We want to, say, monitor Global Delay Val. And we can also do things like Watch Lat A or Latch A in the Special Function Registers. Come on, right there. There we go. Okay. So Latch A, Global Delay Val. Let's take a look at that counter. So let's put that in there as well. New watch. Global counter. Okay, we see here that global counter has gone through 11 times. Latch A is set to 0. And global delay val is set to some weird hexadecimal number, 3E8. Okay, so at this point, what we see is that the global counter and the global delay vals and the latch A values are all viewable from MPLABX, and they're the actual values that are on the chip itself. The other nice thing that can happen here is we can modify those on the fly. So the value for global delay val in hexadecimal is 3E8, and that corresponds roughly, or exactly, actually, to the decimal value 1000. If I change this to be 0E8 and run it, there's no change. Why? Because I forgot to hit enter. Just a minute. I'll hit pause here. I hit enter right there. So global delay val, I've set it to E8 as opposed to 3E8. I've hit enter. That assigns it. Now I'm going to hit continue. And now the frequency's changed. Remember to hit enter when you change the values. Okay, so if I do a change to 0E8, it makes the frequency higher because the delay is smaller. If I hit pause again, change this back to 3E8, which is what it was before, make sure to hit enter. Hit continue. The frequency should be slower. One more time. Let's make that 008. And what ends up happening? Nothing, because I forgot to hit enter again. Pause. 008. Hit enter. Continue. Surprise, surprise, it is so fast, the delay is so small, that you can't actually see it. It's flashing too quickly. So we'll pause it again. Make this 38. Hit enter. Hit continue. And now it's flashing again. You can actually see the flashing going on. So this speaks to a couple of different things. One of them is that it's important to get the value of the variable in question right. If you make it too small or too large, sometimes the effect isn't visible. And second, it's important to hit enter when you actually make that change. And there you go. So you now see how you can modify live, basically, the code running on the microprocessor. And you can see how this is complementary to how you would simulate the processor as well.